Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to respond to the invitation from UCL to speak here, and I'm grateful to you for giving up your time. And I hope I can make it as interesting and maybe a little provocative as well, because it seems that energy seems to be constantly in a state of flux with regard to policy and what's going on. So it's a really interesting time. But that said, when the invitation came, the invitation was to look back and say, well, where, how do we arrive at this point? And I'd had a discussion, was having a discussion with Taj and Bob Lowe about institutional memory and actually the lack of it everywhere. And I'd set up an authority in Oman and it went very well. And then we get bright young Omanis coming in and working, and they'd say to me, so where did the authority come from? And why? And what was before? And that made me think, well, you know, they work for me, they're working, and they don't know. It's important to have to keep a record and to understand the history. And Bob was making the same point about, you know, policy in the UK, which has been rich and varied. So I thought it'd be interesting. I was very happy to respond to the challenge, and it is a challenge, to summarise 90 years or whatever it is of events. Now, I've put a particular slant on it, so I wouldn't hope to cover everything. It would be a terrible talk if I did. So please forgive me if I do not raise the burning issue that you think should be in this presentation. Maybe we'll get to it in a discussion. But the key thing about looking back raises the prospect of, well, we're looking at history, the history of this. And a much more distinguished regulator than I gave a speech some years ago, Philip Lowe at the European Commission. But he quoted Hegel, and Hegel said, nations and governments have never learned anything from history or acted upon any lessons they may have drawn from it. Not sure I agree with that, but it's a nice erudite quote to get us started. What I do agree with a twist, is something I heard Lord Desai from the London School of Economics say on Bloomberg Television just 2 weeks ago when they were discussing the financial crisis. And he used this phrase, which has three topics in it of great interest to me. Hubris reminds us that we don't need a new macroeconomics. Please substitute for macroeconomics energy regulation. So hubris reminds us we don't need a new energy regulation. We have enough old energy regulation, which we have forgotten. If we could just bring that back, if you look at history and economics together, then we will be able to diagnose our predicament and find a solution. I think there's a lot in that. Bit of a stretch, but I think that's something I'm trying to. Now, just to lower the tone before we get started, my own favourite definition of history comes from a play by Alan Bennett called The History Boys. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but it's about preparing northern schoolboys for Oxford exams. And one poor chap is being, you know, Rudge, the hapless Rudge, is being, you know, prepared, and he's asked the question, Rudge, what is history? So he seeks and receives reassurances that he won't be beaten for giving his answer or traduced. And then he said, well, history, miss, is just one after another. And I definitely agree with Rudge. Now, the problem for people like me in situations like this is with so many things, we need a narrative. So I've chosen to try and weave a timeline. So these are the sources. A timeline, which I'll talk us through in a moment, and see if we can then come to a view on, well, where are we? Well, I can answer that question in one sense right now. We're in the middle of a phase two investigation by the Capital, the Competition Markets Authority, I beg their pardon. Now, I don't know how much people know. You may know a lot more about this than I do. But my understanding of these tend not to happen when things are going really well. So the fact there is one means there are stakeholders who are very, very unhappy or concerned about what's happening in the energy market. The process has just been extended. I actually had to redo this chart because I was supposed to do this seminar some months ago, so events are fluid. But in early July, they issued their provisional report for their thinking, so we have an idea what sort of conclusions they're going to come to. And I wonder if we might touch on some of those issues at the end of the timeline, because that would then bring us together, well, where are we, and how is history going to help us understand how to interpret what the CMA is saying about moving forward, because they have a lot to say, and there are some real challenges and problems. So, my approach, just to confirm Rudge's hypothesis, there's all the governments of the day in the UK since 1920. I think when we're talking about policies, about energy and long-term decisions, consistency and continuity are critical. If you have repeated changes of government, then that can be destabling. But those governments have a right, they won an election, to implement the policies that they think are the right ones. And the one thing about new governments is they always have a better way of doing something than the previous lot. So we tend to see these are the departments who have, since 1920, had notional responsibility for energy policy. If it's right to use that phrase, because I'm not sure that the UK has really had what we now think of as an energy policy in its most coherent institutional sense. I think energy has been used to respond to events, as Harold Macmillan called them. But what I want to do is I'm going to step through this timeline. I'm going to divide it in two, from 1920 to 1979, I think for obvious reasons, and from 1979 to today. I'm just going to have a look at what formulated the major policy decisions, some of which still reverberate today in terms of the decisions that this government has to take. Their legacy issues. But just to, this is very data light. I've been at too many presentations when people bombard you with loads of data. I'm not going to do that. But just to say that I looked at some numbers. Here's a very boring presentation of, I'm grateful to DEC for producing a spreadsheet that says his electricity supply in the UK from 1920. How convenient was that for me? Thank you very much. And there it is. Interesting dynamic, I think, particularly at the end. Much more interesting, and something I used to get my colleagues at the authority to do, take a data series, look at it three or four, five, six, seven different ways. Is there something in there that you can learn about? So I couldn't resist just taking the same series and the start of every year to meet Taj's requirement for a decadal view of what's going on. Every year, the index is rebased to 100. So this is telling you what the relative movement is in each year. And I think of this as falling dominoes. For a long time now, I think there's been a sort of reduction in the growth rate of electricity supply as things become more efficient, electricity intensity of GDP is falling. And right at the end, yes, I know there's been a recession in the 2008 crisis, but we're really getting the effect of some energy efficiency policies and others. So I just thought that was an interesting dynamic to have a look at to prepare us for our discussion. Now, what fuel have we been using and have dominated energy policy? Well, coal. And I know there was a statement from the Energy Secretary just last week telling us that whilst in the early stages, for many years, coal was 99% of the fuel, poor diversification there. It's come down for reasons that we'll be stepping through. At the moment, it's 30% of source of generation, and it'll be zero in, is it 2025? So, but it's okay, because we've had some nuclear. Government started a nuclear program in the 50s, late 40s, 50s. Except all of the stations there will all be closed in 2035. I think if the source is correct. So, but it's okay because there's gas. And for part of this period, gas was prohibited from being used to generate electricity, was not allowed. So we've had a dash for gas, thank heavens. And we're going to be a lot more dependent on gas going forward, although I think we're now a net importer of gas, I think. So it's an interesting dynamic just to bear in mind when we start stepping through the history. How do we end up with this sort of array? It would be remiss of me not to add the renewable contribution. Growing, certainly. It's going to need to grow a lot more. And the other is what have you. So that's the background in terms of, you know, core fuel that we use to produce electricity supply. in the UK, or GB, I should say. So, what I'd like to do now is, this is the first of our periods that I just want to talk us through. And then when we get to the end, maybe we can row about it, or you see that I'm keen to pick an argument, or not pick an argument, but to probe these issues. This is a period in which a lot of very interesting things happened, and a lot of them got a bad press because I think people have forgotten the context. And I think worse than that, some people are sort of starting to think, well, why can't we go back and do things like we did then? Which is a really, really, really dangerous line of thought. So let me try and step through it in as neutral a way as possible. In each of our periods, and this is our first period, there's a bar which is when the government had a really fundamental economic philosophy. All governments, when they come in, have a view how they want things done. There's two periods, here and the Thatcher government in the 79, where they're just the economic ideology of that dominated everything, macroeconomic policy and energy policy. And I think it's worth highlighting those periods, but pointing out some things that are not often said about them. So let's get started. I'm just going to walk through this and say, right, well, what happened here? We're going to actually start in 1999, so forgive the inaccuracy, but it's close to 1920, when the first Act was passed. Only 6% of homes had electricity. Over 600 tiny generators, well, some very small, scattered all over the place, no grid, and costs were very high. So the government passed an act, appointed five regulators, actually, commissioners, to say, sort that out. And what they did was they started working to sort out grid, better coordination. There was no ownership, this was not nationalisation. And it produced results, but they were very frustrated that people weren't, they found it very hard to deal with certain private companies, but also municipalities, government, public sector bodies. So, but the benefits that they produced quickly were such that the government introduced another law in 26, gave them a lot more power. And this is where they set up the Central Electricity Agency, I think it was. And things, this is where we now had a national grid. But again, there was no ownership of generation. It was only concentrated at the grid. And then we have a period of time where, by the time we get to the end of the 40s, there had really, really been big improvements at the grid level, reserve sharing. The number of generators had fallen substantially, so economies of scale were being reached. But unfortunately, a lot of those benefits did not percolate to customers, because the distribution level entities, private and municipality, were not that keen to always participate in a way that you need if you were to have a balanced system. Now, I think that's an important point to make, because both of the government interventions thus far, I would say, are very positive. This was after the end of the First World War, by the way. So this is a critical period, government intervention, good benefits, but frustration because people weren't, all parts of the chain were wanting to work in the way that was needed for national benefits. So then there was the war, and then, much to everyone's surprise, the Labour Party won the election in 1945. And they had a very, very clear philosophy about the ownership of the means of production, very socialist government. So when they came in on a nationalisation platform, not just of the energy industries, but pretty much everything, including steel, which was pretty much a lot of private sector companies were wrapped up in that. It was an ideological approach. So, in terms of our focus, and I'm using the electricity industry as a sort of proxy to help us through the narrative. The Electricity Act of 1947 just said, well, we noticed all the problems with distribution levels. I'm not going to mess about with that. Everything nationalised, from generation, transmission, distribution, and supply. And it's all reorganised, and it's all owned by the government. They did that with gas. They did that with coal. I just say quickly, though, that some of these industries were in a very parlous state when the nationalisation policy was implemented. Coal, in particular, was a disaster. It was really suffering from underinvestment. But you saw the chart. The country was totally reliant on coal. And it was also trying to export some coal to help the balance of trade and what have you. So, yes, there was very ideologically driven governance, but let's not forget that there were real practical reasons for doing what this government did. They didn't have to do it that way, but that's the way they chose to do it. So, with the electricity industry then, we have pretty much what was to be for right up until 1979, the electricity industry. Nationalised, owned by government. What form did it take? Well, all the nationalised industries were public corporations. And this became a real sort of institution in the UK. The public corporation was really something. Even though they were boards, the National Coal Board, the area boards of electricity, they were all public corporations. And what did that mean? Well, it meant that they were run by a board, and the board was appointed by the minister, because they all reported to a minister. So the board then had responsibility to run each industry in accordance with the remit given to it, and it had the power to come up with policies needed to drive the industry forward. They weren't waiting for the minister to tell them everything, but the minister had the right, broad powers, to tell them, well, because of the national interest, we want you to do this, or we want you to do that. And that was really a weak point in the chain. That led to problems that we're going to discuss in a moment. So we have a situation where the government's clearly in control. This is the point I want to hammer home, that the government was in control here. Ministers were responsible for whole sectors. They appointed the boards. People who think that energy markets must be controlled by the public sector, this is your absolute nirvana. Okay, how did it work out in practice? That's the issue now. I just want to share a couple of quick anecdotes with you that really amazed me when I was going through the history of this. As soon as the Act was passed and the industry was set up, a Conservative MP said, okay, can we have a select committee to keep an eye on? And the government said, no. Why? Because the government thought, the Labour government that nationalised it and set it all up and ran it, said to have a select committee would be interfering with the public corporations in their running of the industry. Now, I hadn't understood that sort of separation within the mind of the Labour government. The trouble was that they then set up, and they did this with other nationalised industries. You had big industries, and they were big industries, and they were about to double in size, most of them. No supervision in terms of what you would call, or you or I would call, I think, economic or financial supervision. Were they efficient? That's the question we're going to start working towards. So, actually, Mr. Morrison, who was in charge of the deputy leader of the party, beseeched, in his diaries, he beseeched the nationalised industry chairman, and they were all men at the time, said, can you please set up efficiency units to help you decide how you're doing? No, we don't want them. If we had an efficiency unit, it would make people think that we didn't know what we were doing. So they didn't. So then we had a couple of committees came along, and these committees came up with some ideas that I just want to share with you quickly to give you an insight to what was really going on in these industries, which were now a substantial part of the UK economy. The Ridley Committee was asked to look at this, that, and the other, and they came up with this idea that it would be really good to have a tariff advisory committee to advise all of the nationalised industries on what would be a good way to set tariffs that would ensure resources are allocated efficiently. What a fantastic idea. And the chairman said, no, we don't want it. And you can actually see Hansard in the House of Commons saying, we don't want that. We think it would undermine confidence, upset the chaps on the board. People would think we didn't know what we were doing. So that wasn't done. Then the Herbert Committee came along, was asked to look at things. They wanted some restructuring. But the one really interesting thing that they said was that the electricity sector really has to do something about tariffs. Tariffs are not reflecting the cost of the resources being used and leading to inefficiencies. So this is all good stuff. This all starts to sound like basic economics. Then they said the government should immediately remove the statutory obligation on the electricity sector to keep tariffs as simple as possible. I'm talking about the 50s, not what happened in the UK in the last 3 years. This is history, if not repeating, then chiming, as Walt Whitman said. And they also thought it'd be a good idea to have different tariffs for day-night, and for different areas, and for peak, and fixed cost. And then you think, well, the industry wasn't doing that. Wow, that's incredible. Because if by the time we get to the next act of 1957, the industry had more than doubled in size. And it was taxpayers and the government and customers that were paying for that. But were they doing it efficiently? Were resources allocated efficiently? No. Well, there's no evidence to suggest that that was the case. Then there's three papers were issued by successive governments. And this is where I first came across, discovered the nationalised industries, and I think got me really interested in regulation. Because when I started working in regulation, and they just privatised in Scotland, I'd ask the question, well, what do they used to do in government? And everyone used to say, we need to go and look at these three command papers. This was the way that the government, first of all, I think it's a Conservative government, then Labour again. This was the instructions that were given to the nationalised industries on how to implement financial and economic controls. Let's have a look at them. The first one in 61 was the Conservative government, and it said, what we really care about is a financial target. We just want to make sure that your revenues are recovering your costs, and you know, we can have some indication of your performance. It was historic costs, so if there's any accountants or economists, you'll know that that's a big problem. But that was the basic guidance. Not much to do about economic efficiency. That wasn't a priority. And there was no explicit guidance on investment. And if you're an electricity industry or any sort of utility, you grow through investment. Large projects. But if you're not appraising them, how do you know that you're doing it right, etc., etc.? But the government was concerned, in this last bullet point, that the nationalised industries were starting to suck in a high share of the country's resources. And they were worried that the public sector should not be using resources that were having a lower return than the private sector, because that was going to be very, very damaging economically in the long term. So then 1967 comes along, and the Labour government says, no, do this. And this paper here gets wide praise from welfare economists. They say, if you're going to do something with the nationalised industry, this is the way to do it. Do what? Well, the focus is on efficient allocation of resources. So it's on economics, not finance. So, and people were told to use pricing based on long-run marginal costs. I don't know if there's any economists here, but this is the sort of thing that gets economists excited. And everyone else switches off, so I won't labour it. It came to a very sticky end, and I'll share that with you in just a few moments. But that's what they were told to do. The Treasury, not the department, the Treasury told all the nationalised industries, when you do your project appraisal, which we want you to do, you're to use the net present value method, so discounted cash flow, you've got to use a test discount rate, there it is, and we want to see you justifying what you're doing. The trouble is that's pretty much where the guidance stops. And if you say to somebody, use the net present value to do your projects, and there's a discount rate, the net present value rule says you do all your projects until the net present value is zero. So what happens about sucking in more capital if they all wanted to go and do all these projects? There's a real flaw. But don't worry, because the chairman didn't understand it. So it was never fully implemented. So then we're back to 1978, and we have a Labour government, and they said, right, here's what we want you to do. Forget all that economic stuff. Financial controls. We've gone from finance to economics back to finance. Now the question I would put to you, I don't need to go through the rest of it, because it's very technical, and there's a great article by David Hill. I have a list of articles that I'm getting all this stuff from, I'm happy to share afterwards. And this was a really seminal article by David Held, who really did a number on this. The question I've put to you, generally, if you're running a nationalised industry and your government says, do this, no, do this, Actually, do this. How are you going to run your industry? Everybody, let's just recap. Everything was owned by the government. Minister in charge of each sector. Boards of all the nationalised entities appointed by the minister. All public sector. But it wasn't efficient. The government had serious flaws. It couldn't get its act together in terms of giving guidance. Now, the reason I'm so interested in this, because I actually went through these papers, and you can trace, this is the early DNA, of, I believe, of what the utility regulators do today. We'll come to that in just a second when we come to our next phase. But I've added one further line there. If anybody wants to get a really good insight into what these industries were like, or the electricity industry, in 1981, yes, I've stepped over into the new period and the Conservative government, which we'll come to in a sec. But the MMC issued a report on the Central Electricity Generating Board, and it's a fantastic read. You will not believe the complexity that had built up in these industries. And I think if you read that, you might then have a better understanding of why what happened next happened. I don't know if there's any... So, this was all very poor practice on the part of the government. And don't forget, there were now balance of payments crises going on, inflation was taking off, there was real issues going all around the world, oil price things, and huge nationalised industries really didn't have proper governance and guidance in terms of what they were doing. Now, but what about competition, you might ask? Well, it's not much of a better story there. And I found an excellent assessment by the London School of Economics, a lawyer there, who does a history of competition policy. He actually starts in 1414 with the principle of restricted trade, which I'm not going to go into. But the first piece of legislation that fits into what we think of today as competition law was the Monopolies and Restrictive Practices Act in 1947. That act, when it came out, basically didn't make anything illegal or wrong. It just said, it was trying to plant the idea, you know, restrictive practices are bad, and monopoly bad, can be bad, so we want to do something about it. But this apparently sent a shiver through both the public and private sector businesses to hear the government say in law that something was bad, and that something was actually what was the way they did business. The UK economy at this time was riddled with restrictive practices. And there's nothing, I think this might make it in a strong way, there's nothing to support the efficiency of the nationalised industries could come from what we now today think of competition policy. The next Act 56, that had more teeth. People were realising we've really got to get stuck into it. So that's thought of being a big step. The Monopolies and Mergers Act actually then introduced, renamed what we came to know as the Monopolies and Mergers Commission. And a really big step forward, according to the historian, is the Fair Trading Act of 73, which set up the Office of Fair Trading. So we now have the Monopolies and Mergers Commission and the Office of Fair Trading. But we still didn't really have anything that was what we would call competition law. This was all about correcting bad things that would distort competition, certainly, but the principle of competition being the driving force was not really reflected in this legislation. So we get to the end of this period, and it had been a tough period, a difficult period for the nationalised industries. They had grown substantially, but the government was now really concerned about funding them. They were sucking in a lot of money. It wasn't clear that resources were being allocated efficiently, which was damaging other parts of the economy, etc., etc. So things changed, and things changed rapidly. I wondered how to present this idea to you, and I settled on the idea that here's two quotes. The first is from Nigel Lawson, who was the Minister for Energy under the Thatcher government, who both before that and in that position drove a lot of the privatisation policies. So by the 19, so they came in 79. By 1992, two-thirds of the formerly state-owned enterprises had been transferred to the public sector. 46 businesses, major businesses, 900,000 people had been privatised. I found this, I really like this blunt statement here from the Royal Commission on Environmental Pollution, the big 1920 report that led to so much environmental policy initiative. In 1980, the state owned gas, coal, nuclear and electricity, as well as having a major stake in the oil industry. By 2000, it owned nothing. I think by any measure, that's an incredible change. Particularly, I hope, in light of the fact that we've just walked through decade after decade of the government trying to run these industries. I just want to make one final point before we move on. That what the Conservatives that beat the Labour government that had nationalised the industries, when the Conservatives came in, they won two more elections after that. They had three terms. They ran the nationalised industries. They didn't reverse the policy. So the longest period of time we've had of nationalised industries under the stewardship of a particular party has been under the Conservative Party. I hadn't quite appreciated that before, because that's really not what you think when you look back and say, oh, Labour Party, nationalisation, blah, blah, blah. So now, let's get back to our second period of analysis. We're going to go from 1979 to today. I'm now focusing on gas and electricity, steel specifically. And much to my delight, here come a new type of institution to regulate these industries that have been privatised. Here comes the gas. Gas was privatised in 86. Unfortunately, as in a pretty monopolistic structure, the idea was that liberalisation would have more benefits that actually materialised, and that the idea of breaking them up was not really seized on. Less so with electricity, where the lesson was being learned. So there was much more restructuring for the Electricity Act, for the electricity privatisations. But the key point here is they both had independent regulators set up to regulate the sector and to do all of the difficult, complicated things and more that were in those white papers. So it wasn't, the regulator doesn't say to the company, can you please try and do that? It's, well, you will do that, or you'll have a problem with us. Regulators have real countervailing power against companies that they regulate. And they should use that very carefully. But it has been, I assert, one of the reasons why the industries that were privatised and independently regulated were able to improve their performance under a number of measures. Now, next, we have the Utilities Act in 2000, which merged the gas and electricity regulator together. Well, I look at that as progression, not radical change. Nobody was saying, oh, it hasn't worked, so let's do something else. They were saying, let's bring them together. Yes, under here, you used to get letters from Offer, the electricity regulator, Professor Littlechild, who I had the privilege of working with, used to write to them and say, I have decided, you will do this, this, this. That really upset people. So in the Gas and Electricity Markets Authority, we have a board. And it's we have decided. And this apparently makes such a big difference, but you'll sense my irritation. But anyway, we move with the times. The key point was, this was bringing gas and electricity together. This was a consolidation of regulation. And to my mind, confirmation that it was working well, producing good results. Not in all respects, but in a lot of respects. We get to the Electricity Act. I think there are some problems on the horizon. And if I just park those for the moment under erosion of regulatory independence, question mark. I think I want to come back to that later. But some of that came through in that act, which we might want to come back to. What about the competition? We had this principle in 1414, and we had our first act in Monopolies and Mergers Act in 1947, I think it was. Well, here's the two bodies that were existing at the time. And we had a very important act came in 1998. And if you read, when I read the, I had appreciated this, when I read the LSE account, this just swept up competition law in the UK and brought it up to date in a number of respects. One, consistent with European legislation, Article 81 and 82. And two, really, really focusing and talking about competition. And that was followed shortly afterwards by, sorry, that's a mistake. That should say the Enterprise Act. No, it's not a mistake, it's right. When the Enterprise Act, up to here, these people would do investigations of monopolies and mergers and the rest of it. And they go to a Secretary of State and say, well, Secretary of State, we think you should reject this or accept it. And a lot of the time, the Secretary of State said, well, thanks a lot for your advice. I'm going to do something else. By the Enterprise Act of 2002, they had given institutional independence to the authorities. So they would investigate and they would decide. Only in very exceptional circumstances where you could tick a box, you know, national security or something. So it's all much better. It's all getting stronger. And the emphasis is on competition. And then we have the Enterprise and Regulatory Reform Act, which brings together the Competition Commission, the Office of Fair Trading, in a new Competition Market Authority, an independent competition regulator responsible for everything to do with competition, mergers, restrictive practices. By the way, just last week, they issued a finding of a survey that about, I think it's about 60% of small businesses don't understand what a restrictive practice is. So maybe we've been a bit too harsh on the early laws that were focusing on restrictive practices. So this is really lauded. I was surprised to see it. This was really lauded in terms of shaping institutional regulation in this period. At the top, the utility regulators. At the bottom, the Competition and Markets Authority. And in the Enterprise Act, it actually brings them together, where utility regulators now are going to meet regularly with the CMA, share ideas, ensure consistency and policy decisions. And I think that's really good. Then everything changed. I've run to the end, so I'm being a bit anachronistic. Please forgive me. But what I wanted to say is that that absolutely, in my view, changed everything. I'm sure I'm not telling anybody something they don't know. What is this? This is the Climate Change Act in 2008. What did it do? It said that the UK government will commit to doing certain things. We're going to reduce emissions. And it's a legal obligation to do it. If you look back over my slide when I'm talking through nationalisation and all the command papers, these were all, would you please think about doing this? Or it would be really nice if you could do that. This is different. This is saying the government's, the country's committed to that. Now, I think that had a profound effect on the regulator. Because the regulator, the independent regulator, saying, well, if this is what we've got to do, the way we're going, we're not going to be able to do it. Why did he say that? Because that is the, and I'm very grateful to the National Audit Office. Sorry, you see, I've taken these two excellent charts from a fantastic PDF interactive document produced by the National Audit Office, and it is fantastic to say that's what the commitment is, because that's what we've got to do if we're going to meet the commitment. But what this is saying is that we're going to get rid of coal. I'm sorry, the only thing I'd say is the colours. I wish you had the colours were slightly different. But I wanted coal should always be black in my view, for obvious reasons. I think the interesting thing, and I'll top this thing, combustion and CCS, well, that's cancelled a few weeks ago. Actually, the day after the budget, there was nothing about it in the budget. But the billion that was earmarked for that is now gone. So this is out of date. If this is what we're committed to with using these sorts of technologies, This has also changed as well, because the coal here will be gone earlier, no extensions, etc. But anyway, my point is that it had a profound effect, in my view, on the regulator, because you had a regulator saying, okay, Mr. Policy, if this is the policy you want to follow, we're not going to get there on the current path. So things have got to change. And that's what triggered the electricity market reforms that are now being delivered by DEC. I'd like this to, not that I'm leading you to a discussion or arguing about something. Why is DEC leading these? Isn't that the regulator's job? Anyway, just think about that. But that's where we are. Now, I just want to, as we career towards the end, I'm just a few minutes over time, so I'll go very fast through this. Don't forget that for transmission and distribution, from 1990, has been, I think, a real success. There are 20 years of RPI minus X. People try to stick another Y or a Z or something on it. But the basic formula of incentive regulation has really produced benefits. Ofgem itself reviewed it after 20 years and said, look, if we're going to meet all this new environment stuff, we need to change the way we regulate. I think it's a really healthy thing to do. So they've come up with a revenue equals innovation incentive output scheme. I hope I've got that right. And I came across this actually when I was speaking at a global summit in February, doing my research for that event, and I came across a 500-page paper, everything seems to be over hundreds of pages, from the American Council for an Energy Efficient Economy. And they're screaming at their own regulator saying, can you please look at what's going on in the UK? Because you are stuck with rate of return regulation. They've had incentive regulation under the RPI minus X, and now they've changed it because they've got to innovate the way they regulate networks to facilitate the connections of new technologies, renewables, metering, different ways of doing things. I think that's a real achievement. In generation, we had for 11 years the pool, which I loved, and then that was changed in 2001 to a bilateral set of changing arrangements, which has caused problems. But the CMA thinks it's a much better competitive way of doing things. So, and in supply, well, all electricity customers from 2000, by 2000 were able to choose their supplier. Lots of them choose not to, but that's the real message to come out of the competition review. And it was even earlier with gas. And I must mention Project Discovery. That was the really interesting analysis undertaken by the regulator to say to the government, look, if you're really committed now, as you are, as we all are, to the 2008 Energy Climate Change Act, these are the scenarios that we're facing under present policies. So I'm very proud and delighted that the regulator took the initiative to stimulate the change, to say, right, you signed up to the policy quick enough, and there was political consensus on the policy, but we don't have the policies to get there. So that's all in one. I'll walk through from 1920 to today, when we've had nationalised, period of nationalisation here, real struggle to manage and incentivise and get economic performance out of them. I think there were more outages and security supply issues in this period than in this period. Statistics will affirm that. So the idea that the government needs to be involved and own things and do things to have a better energy system is not, I think, in the UK borne out by evidence. But the government is absolutely right to, has the right, given the democratic process, to set policy. Why it wants to go beyond that and interfere with implementation, I simply don't understand. Because the evidence of this period is, it didn't really work very well. So after all of that, we're on. I think we're at the stage where we have a profound challenge in this country to meet the 2008 legal obligations in the Act. The coalition government introduced a lot of measures and a lot of things, and they're being dismantled, so we have policy uncertainty. So I'm going to stop, actually, because I could go on and say things, particularly about the erosion of independent regulation. And the people who suffer most from the erosion of independent regulation are customers. Because whilst the government likes to tell you that it's so concerned about customers, this, that, yeah, it's actually the regulators that have been protecting and have for a long time statutory obligation to protect customers. And if that is blunted in any way by requiring the regulators to give more primacy to the policies of debt, then as Tim Tuttle in an excellent article saying, well, do we still have independent regulation? That has been such a success, some of us believe, for such a long time. So we seem to be at a real interesting point. And so at this point, it'd be good to open up the Capital Market Authority, the Competition Market Authority reports, to see what they're saying. But anyway, I hope that's been of interest. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions and argue and what have you.
Probably about 15 minutes for question time before we go up to have a drink. So, who would like to ask the first question?
Right. I'm Jonathan Radford from the University of Birmingham. Really enjoyed your talk, and I teach energy economics to engineers, so I find it fascinating.
Good luck.
I'm sure they always do. Yeah. But one of the things I struggle with is around costs and cost to customers. And especially when policy gets involved, whether it's over a sort of short-term or a longer-term cost. And especially at the moment, the concern being about keeping costs down in the short-term for customers, obviously the regulator
affordability. Pushing
affordability, whereas over the longer-term, if we're thinking about 2030 and beyond, actually, we might be doing quite different things. We might be bringing or incentivizing different technologies or different innovation. And how does one balance both of those? Because if you look at the 1990s, one of the things that was decimated by privatisation was R&D. They went practically zero, and it took intervention to get that back up and running. So, you know, yeah. Private industry wasn't that concerned about short term.
Well, I think that's a fair point. I think though that if you look at the decisions that DEC has taken and is saying, look, we want to find an underpin for the long-term security of supply. When the coal's gone, we need to bring some new nuclear. So it's signing these contracts for differences. They're fixed price contracts. Can we please call them what they are? And they're pretty chunky, as the National Audit Office is telling us. Because if those contracts aren't led through a competitive process, then customers now and in the future are both going to pay more. If you have that underpinning, I think then what the government is thinking, and I think the regulator is definitely thinking, is saying, well, we should then populate the rest of the system with maybe things that we don't think of today. Let's not have everything. Let's not do everything as we'll decide today what the technology is for the next 30 years are going to be. Because that generally doesn't work well. So I accept that there has to be a balance. I'm a bit concerned that this discussion then leads on and says, right, so we can't rely on markets, so how else are we going to do it? I don't agree with that. I think that if you've got to underpin it, and I do have some sympathy with the government's view, unless you can see the contracts or where the new capacity is coming from, then I think that raises concern. But my question for Amber Rudd is, you've said, right, no coal, we're going to need a lot more gas. How is that gas capacity going to be procured? Because I'm pretty sure that the capacity mechanism isn't going to do it. It's not intended to do that, in my view. So I think you've rightly pointed to an issue that's complex in all markets. But I would look in the networks and say, I think Ofgem is doing something really interesting and innovative in recognising that we do need to innovate. And we shouldn't be second-guessing or taking the decision, central planning, everything. But we've got to balance that with security of supply. And I think there's a role for markets in the middle, because that's where the best place for making sure that costs are efficient.
Yeah. So it's been slightly curious to me that the Conservative government has really been favouring nuclear in the 1980s and now, even though it's quite expensive, isn't it? You know, it's not.
It's twice the present. The paradox is through this time, it really surprised me. Labour Party nationalisation, yet it was run for a long time by a Conservative government. Then when you have the privatisation process, despite having manifesto pledges to reverse it all, they didn't. So I think what happens with politicians is when you're confronted with the brutal reality of the scale of some of these decisions, you tend to say, well, can we live with what we've got and just do this, that and the other? The trouble is at the moment, because of the 2008 Act and the commitment to the emissions, capacity is being taken out of the market. And the market of itself is just not going to provide new capacity because it's all about carbon. The carbon price is not being priced properly. So I think it's a false argument to say, oh, the market can't provide. You're not providing the conditions to allow the market to provide. But I take your point in R&D. Absolutely.
So why do you say the capacity mechanism isn't going to deal with new build?
Why do I say?
The capacity mechanism.
Right.
But I do agree with you, but I think it is designed to expand its value.
Yeah. I think that I must put this down. You see, the pool.
Yeah.
The pool was administered. Yes, administered. That's why the pure economists hate it. Because anything that's administered is not a market. It's second best to a market, so let's get rid of it. But it had three components. And that component there was capacity mechanism.
Yeah, which explains why it's not.
Well, indeed, I spent a lot of time with the ESB talking about this. Right, and they're fighting the Europeans.
Yeah, I worked for the ESB.
Okay, well, we'll compare those later. Because Europe is saying to them, get rid of your capacity market.
Yeah,
but now we're here. Anyway, let's answer your first question. Then they brought in Netta, which is an energy only market, one number. All these things here are in the one number. Trouble is that people are looking at that one number, and it's been quite low for a while, and saying, well, I don't see how my capacity is going to be remunerated. But now, where did this Netta come from? It came from Ofgem, and they'd actually had some special people advising them on it. One of them, who is presently the chairman of the Competition Markets Authority, who I've just pronounced, we don't see anything wrong with Netta. So then you say, okay, well, if that's supposed to be everything, and we had the pool before, which had three components, we're now saying, and now we need a capacity mechanism. So every year, they're going to be this in a certain time of the year, saying, right, how much do we need? Let's manage and control it. Whereas, the sort of, when we had the dash gas for gas before, that was producing the volume of gas capacity that was needed, those decisions aren't always taken in December. You know, they're taken by numerous players, taking over a longer horizon, saying we need to commit here. The idea that one mechanism that is designed to make sure at certain times in the winter, so I nearly said the summer, back in the winter, is going to provide us with enough to ensure everything's okay, including demand side management, which we strongly support, that's fundamentally different. My last point is, if we've now got a capacity mechanism going on top of this, then don't we have four? Are we not double counting capacity? So I think the whole design and thought of it is, I think, misplaced. What I would say is, it was the regulator who designed Netta, but it's DEC that's designed the capacity mechanism and is overseeing its implementation.
The first one was proven was that it was subject to abuse.
Absolutely. That's a fair point.
Yeah.
The problem with the pool was, I think, in my view, that this mechanism had a lot of fantastic characteristics to it. When the government set the generating market loose at privatisation, it was heavily concentrated. And when you give people market power in a market, they tend to use it. So the people were gaming the mechanism because they could. What is something of an irony is just before the new arrangements came in, they made the two worst culprits, I don't mind if this is on camera, the National Power and PowerGen, made them divest 2 gigawatts of plant. And that's when then prices started coming down. If they'd have done that here and removed the power from the two dominant generators, I think the poll would have worked very differently and maybe would not have been replaced. So I'm a big fan of polls, big fan of what they're doing in Ireland, and have concerns about the capacity mechanism.
In Ireland, you mean ISAM or the current market?
The current market, but they haven't actually had a capacity.
Capacity mechanism in Ireland does fish in excess capacity. You know, one has to be avoided having gone in 5 years and still getting 40 million a year.
So you can't win, can you? You're either too much or too little. But what's needed is a well-functioning market with a price signal. Neta apparently doesn't give you a clear price signal on capacity. I think DEC has been a bit quick to say, that's a market failure. That's it.
Sorry. Eric is in National Audit Office. I mean, I just wonder whether you'd like to comment on the extent to which the UK has been kind of unusual in the extent to which it's exposed its energy market to private competition, in the sense that many other countries have not. You know, we look at France, EDF and Rika are 85% owned by the state. You know, many other countries, including America, have lots of legislation down to state level about the ownership, state ownership of energy companies.
Yeah.
We do not actually live in a world where most energy markets are privately operated and privately, you know, organized, you know, on this sort of basis. Now, you know, we are potentially going to sign a deal with EDF to allow the Chinese, you know, potential control of Bradwell. You know, now there are very few other countries in the world which would go to that extent. Do you think that, you know, how many of these issues relate to the extent to which we're radically pursued a marketisation, you know, program?
Well, I think you've articulated the point very well. I think, helpfully, I don't see the problem. And this was an issue that came up in Oman. We had to get involved in a capacity where, you know, foreign government, because they wholly owned a company that was trundling in and saying, oh, we want to do that, we want to win that competition for that power station. Then the question is, well, supposing that foreign government falls out with our government and you get all that. To me, provided you get the pressures right, through licensing, financial obligations, you know, countervailing considerations that take away the incentive for a foreign government. It was actually EDF, I don't want to give too much away, but we got involved in that and they put in a formal submission that said, look, because even though we're owned by the French government, here's some reasons why we don't think it's a problem. One, the government doesn't appoint all the board members. Two, the company is subject to a different regulator in Europe and you in this country. And there's all sorts of other pressures. And I found them very persuasive. So I don't worry of itself, the ownership, unless you allow concentration. Pick a country, it'd be wrong of me to say that. If you allow country X to own 90% of the assets in your market, then that's not an energy discussion, that's a political discussion. But you can deal with that, as we did in Oman, by imposing maximum limits to which companies, even if they're owned by foreign governments, don't care, can build up a stake. I'm not too worried about that, to be honest with you. I think if you get the market design right, that is really what's necessary, and the competitive pressures. And just hope then that the government doesn't cave in if it's EDF or the Chinese, when they have an unexpected problem and their double-priced contract isn't giving them enough money and they come in wanting to, you know, the government should say, that's why you need an independent regulator, to say no. I hope that answers your...
I'm from India and I'm studying the budget scores economics and policy of energy and environment. So thankfully, maybe we have learned a lot from UK because our policies, I mean, it looked like you have taken me through our history of electricity acts and policies. And thankfully, you have regulator, which is completely independent, and it just depends on the national tariff policy and the electricity act in 2003. But we've got a problem where the
the golden word, cost-effective tariff, where this distribution companies are still under the purview of the state governments, where they do not allow tariff increase. So, and that's one problem. And another one is, I was surprised that gas and electricity were under the authority of one. That is not the case in India, though we have more than 50% electricity coming from coal. We have a regulator only for the electricity and not for the fuel. So, and right now what has happened is, we have 100% growth from 2003 till 2013 for generation sector, but not in fuel, where the coal mining hasn't really picked up. Yeah. So what do you see that, because everybody is grappling with the same problem, that how do we regulate fuel and the energy market? And also, because that, just to conclude, we got a policy clearly mentioning in first two lines that we got to have affordable, accessible and reliable energy, but there's no word about green. So to generate investment, what should be the way forward for the country then?
There's quite a lot of questions there. It's all interesting. But I think, can I just pick your last point?
Yes.
And just get something off my chest that really irritates me a little bit. What does affordable mean? Well, if something's cost reflective, does that mean that you can afford it? I think this is where this whole thing has become, you know, let's use some new words. So let's say affordability. Whereas, you know, it used to be where the regulators were very focused on ensuring that, you know, markets worked efficiently, costs were driven down, and the charges to customers reflected those costs. That's being eroded, and I think it's a mistake. In terms of the cost-effective tariff, we had exactly the same issue in Oman, where I was really pushing hard to have cost-effective tariffs, and trying to persuade the government that while, yes, you'd have a lot of people on low incomes who would be hit, the efficient way to deal with that is for you to go and introduce some mechanisms to compensate them, to make subsidies targeted in a different way. But what the cost-reflective tariff would do would get people to moderate their energy consumption. And I don't know anything else that does that as effectively as a cost-reflective tariff. So maybe we'll talk again upstairs, because there's a lot of really interesting... India is a really interesting state of development for people in energy.
Just one last question.
Secondly, I'm a PhD student here. I have a question about recent developments in your narrative. It's one of the recent developments is that people come up with community energy initiatives where they're trying to generate their own energy. And it's not huge yet if you look at the whole system.
Yeah.
But it's definitely radically different in character compared to big private companies generating electricity. So, yeah, what are your thoughts on that? Is that a new chapter in the story?
I think it started already. I think that this whole idea that we should be thinking of things in terms of smaller units, allowing, you know, communities or homes or whatever, we should be facilitating the way they want to use technologies to meet themselves. The issue then comes, well, the grid has to be receptive to that. Because if the grid says, no, I'm only interested in signing if you're this size or only want this, then none of that is going to find itself its way to the grid. The changes I spoke about in the Electricity Act was a direct intervention for government to change the rules to make sure that if people wanted access to small community generators, renewable units, what have you, they wanted access to the grid, the licenses were changed and the obligation placed on the system operators to do that. And that's why Ofgem, under its RIIO project, is incentivizing the system operator to say, look, innovate and find ways so you can receive these new, different, smaller types of technologies, but in an economic way, rather than just say you've got to connect them. Let's find a good way, both technically and economically, to say this is a direction we should be going. So the answer to your question is, I think it's already started, and there has already been legislative change to make sure that it's that there's not a barrier to entry in the regulatory regime, stopping those sorts of developments. Whether they get money to get going, that's a different matter. But in terms of getting a connection and being facilitated and not being excluded or precluded, I think that there's already been progress in that regard.
Also, when it's a community generating electricity for the community itself,
yeah,
which is essentially very anti-competitive because it wouldn't be participating in the whole market.
Well, not necessarily. What's the market?
Can I just point out that there's been some pressure in, for instance, California from state energy companies to try and impose a tax on people who go offline and generate, you know, their own electricity.
Yeah.
So, you know, it could
indeed
introduce.
And they should get, well, that's the companies, because they don't like it. And the companies should get a message from the regulator that says, you know what, no. Which is why these changes, I think you'll find, it's not for a company to decide whether a community wants to do something. I think the issue there is, if the community then decides to do something, then, you know, for years, the setup has allowed that to happen. We have private distribution networks, actually, in the UK, where it had to be dealt with under a special instrument at the time of privatisation. They existed, they exist. The issue is within them, and we had this in Oman as well, you want to make sure that people within that community say, right, we're now going to, you're now a sub-market, so it's not anti-competitive to us. If you want to do that, that's fine. But just to make sure that if there's anyone in that sub-market, make sure that they're not open to abuse by somebody within that market. So it's taking everything down the level. But ultimately, people who participate are going to have to take responsibility. If you want to be in there, you're signing up for that. This is what I used to say in Oman. You need to be aware of what you're signing up to. But I think to answer your general point, I don't know of anything in the UK that would prohibit, frustrate, or limit those sorts of developments. Quite the reverse, I think. I don't care what the company's thoughts about it. It's California.
Okay, well, the bells are tolling.